Hey everybody, that's me in the video, and it's me talking, and it's me talking in the video, as I'm talking on this microphone. Confusing, huh? Well, here's what's going on today. I figured out how to do a voiceover, and I'm going to do a voiceover, and we're going to talk about line choice, and how to do what, and why I do what, and that's it. Line choice, bike setup, you know, whatever we talk about. It'll be fun. All right, so I start the video. We're talking about this DRZ. This thing's cool, right? Well, XR was having trouble, so I geared up the DRZ. I thought I was going to go racing on it, but old Kyle, Moto4Play, got the XR ready to go. All right, so we go get gas. You guys want to hear a funny story? Well, I just did a voiceover a minute ago, but the destination for the file went to my C drive, which wasn't big enough, so I talked for 25 minutes and didn't work. All right, this is the starting line. Let's go over real quick what I was talking about on the video. We have 1 minute intervals, and I was doing the starting procedure on the XR, and then during that 1 minute interval, I don't know what was happening. It just wasn't starting first kick like it always does. And maybe something evaporates. Maybe there's fuel in the cylinder and it evaporates. So he just said 30 seconds. I'm just now doing my starting procedure there. And I figure if it's less than 10 seconds, it may fire. And this is good. It worked. We got a KTM. We got a Sherco. We got me. This is my dad, Scary Gary. If anybody's not familiar with Le Mans starts, I use a starting box. Most guys do if they're doing kickstarts. And I started in neutral. Okay, so that, you know, you jump over your bike. My dad's got a ribbon there. And the ribbon's just to help, you know, keep the kicker back to where you can kick in a downward motion instead of kicking in a back and down motion. I started in neutral. This XR, so start, shift into first. This XR does not like to shift under a load, so I lose a lot of time here. I have to like let off the gas to shift into second, and really slowed me down. Here we got Brian McCall, been racing since I was a kid against him. This is Nicholas Cardona. Take note of his name. It's Nicholas, like the I think it'd be a Spanish spelling. And Google Nicholas Cardona Dakar Rally. Oh, my phone just, okay Googled and started Googling him while I'm talking. Anyway, he does Dakar Rally. Pretty cool. I've never met him in person, but raced against him a lot. All right, so I'm in third place. Let's talk about line choice. Quiet on the set, Google. Okay, let's talk about line choice for this first mile. Basic stuff here. You're not going to pass anybody if you're in the same line as them. You're also going to get roosted if you're in the same line as them. So we're trying to A, not get roosted, and then we're trying to B, make passes when we can. It's a pretty good assumption that Nicholas here is going to take the main line on the outside. It's a pretty good assumption that Brian's going to take the next line inside of that. Well, that leaves me looking for green grass on the inside. You'll hear me talk about that a lot. So I'm going to cut this really inside, and I'm going to end up in the green grass, and I won't get roosted. Boom. Look at how tight I'm cutting this. You got to really get on in there. You got to get on in there and get to that green grass. If I had a faster bike, I would have made both of those passes right there, I promise. This is kind of an embarrassing straightaway here. I saw them both let off the gas a little bit, so I did too. Now, we get a practice lap here, but you can't remember every corner. Turns out the corner is way up here. This was actually like a long straightaway. We could have been wide open. Both of them let off the gas. I could have made a pass on Brian right there if I knew the track better. So now we're just trying not to get roosted. We're trying to not take the same line. So again, Nicholas goes outside. This time I see Brian going inside, so I'm going to try this middle line here. Now I wonder if Brian did that on purpose. because he heard me take the inside line on the first corner, so maybe he knew I was going there on the second, on the next right-hander, so he wanted to guard that. Here we got again, Nicholas going outside, Brian's going inside. In this corner, I decided to go inside, and then it just wasn't enough. I didn't think I could hold that speed, so I went ahead and bailed, and I straightened it out and got roosted because of it. Brian checks up here a little bit. He was cautious. I went ahead and went around him. All right, now I'm in second place. Now I've got this guy in front of me, Nicholas Cardona. I've raced against him a few times. I always know that I finished a little bit ahead of him. So I know I'm going to make this pass. I'm just going to be patient. You know what I'm not going to do? I'm not going to get in this. Okay, do you see that? That's a way to ruin a two-hour race. So I'm not getting in that. I'm staying inside. And I just got to set up a pass. So here's my goal. I decide this is where I'm going to make this pass. I'm going to make it right here on this right-hander. My job here is to come into this right-hander as neutral as possible to where I can decide in a split second whether to go inside or outside. I'm going to go the opposite way he does, period, and I'm going to go faster than he does, and I'm going to make the pass. So I stay neutral, neutral, neutral. As soon as I decide that he's setting into that outside line, I'm cutting it right hard, and I'm getting on the gas, and I'm making that pass. And now we're in the lead, and this is the first time in the history of the entire universe that an XR 600 has been in the lead in the 30-plus class in the Florida Trail Rider Series. I'm going to fast-forward this. I'm going to make it, you know, it shouldn't be a long video. Show you a couple of cool lines, why I do what. Here's an example of, you know, like a cheater line or an A line. You see the track goes over here and turns right, but nobody's going there. If you're going over there, you weren't paying attention. You got to duck in here. And we got some zigzags, and eventually we get over here to where the quads were. Or we're probably there now. Creek crossing coming up. A couple things. You'll see me crossing creeks all the time in these videos, and you'll see my legs sticking forward. Have you seen that in any textbook riding schools? No? Well, it's because old fast guy here on a slow bike hates wet feet. I hate wet feet. And I don't want wet hands, and I don't want wet goggles. So I'm going to go ahead and go slow through that creek, and I'm going to put my feet up. And this is a two-hour race, and that's not where it's being won or lost, is in that creek. Run a little ridge here. Now Dustin Morgan is behind me. Dustin is an ex overall FTR champion. He's one of the top five guys in our series any day of the week. I look back right here. My eyes can see him, but you can't see my camera. He kind of took a cool line off the ridge there. All right, check this out. I missed some double greens. They're way up there. My eyes are already locked on this berm. I don't even see those things. But I do hear Dustin go, "Hey!" So I look back, I see he's taking the outside line. I think to myself, there must be double greens there if he's taking that worse, I shouldn't say bad line, but it's a worse line. So mental note, next lap, if there's double greens there, go through those. I didn't think it was worth turning around and going backwards on the track over. And here we go. So we're racing. I know already that I'm not going to slow him up. He's been beating me by 6 to 8 minutes a race.
He's been getting like fifth overall.
Sometimes up to 2 minutes a lap he's been beating me by. This race he only got me by like 5 seconds on the first lap. He bobbles right here. Look at him. I think he did this because he wanted to be on camera. Let's watch it a couple more times in case he watches this video. That's textbook right there. But he's got electric start, so he fires it back up. If that was an XR 600, he would have lost at least 60 seconds. And I'll fast forward through this crappy part of the course. This is just bombed out stuff that the quads ruined. This had never been ridden on until Saturday morning before the race. The quads raced it and ruined it. Show you guys some palmettos here. I don't really know how far north palmettos grow. North Florida, Georgia, Alabama. If any of you Seacher guys are watching this, let me know if you have to deal with palmettos. But this is it. This is a pretty mild section of palmettos. I think they went through here with maybe a machine, or maybe this had been dug out as like a fire break or something, but very mild. But you still have to be cautious on these things. They'll kick you off the bike for sure. The XR600 is pretty hard to deflect left or right, so as long as you're going straight over them and not doing an extreme lean or extreme braking, it's pretty good about keeping straight. At this point, I'm still super impressed that I'm in sight of Dustin. He's normally on a whole different pace as me. We're in the sand whoops here now. You'll see me crossing back and forth to try to get outside of the main line, just because that's where the smooth stuff is. But it's a catch-22, because if you are on the edge of the track, you're closer to the palmettos. We got a straightaway coming up here. Watch how much time he gets on me right here. I mean, he gets on the gas right there and just completely checks out. I don't know if his arms are that much stronger than mine that he can hold on and hold on to the gas like that, but I didn't have it in me. My hands were hurting already from this stiff throttle. We had a pretty wild ditch here to cross. This completely bottoms out the XR. Clank. The flex bars help a lot in situations like that, but it's hard on the bike. I'm getting my frame is like broken now from my swing arm bolt having so many hard hits that it's turning the hole into an oval. So now we got good trail. This is new trail. Never been raced on by quads. Only the bikes this morning, I think. This morning I was the first one out for practice. And I was the first race bike on this trail. When I went by this morning, it was completely fresh. I think maybe the people that went by and hung arrows up on quads are all that had been on it. And that's good. We don't get a lot of that. All right, now we're catching A-Riders. Our series starts the AA riders first, 1 minute later A open, 1 minute later the A250, A200 line, 1 minute later 30 plus, that's what I'm racing. So when I'm catching these guys, these are guys that I'm catching on the first lap of every race. They're no stranger to having a couple of the faster 30 plus riders pass them. I'm no stranger to passing them. I thought we were all friends. It turns out that Gavin up here in the pink must have some kind of problem with me, because there's really no other reason why he wouldn't let me by, why he wanted to hold me up. So you see that A250 rider let me by. Dustin makes the pass on Gavin right there. He has a nice two-line area to get around him. Well, now I end up behind Gavin, and there's really not a lot of room to pass. Now, to be clear, I can pass him. I've already gained a minute on him in just less than 10 minutes. So moving at a much faster pace. At this point, as of right now, he is holding me up, and he knows he's holding me up. He knows I'm not in his class because he's racing A200. There's no four strokes in A200. He knows I pass him around this time every race. He's got an A250 rider in front of him, so I'm not interrupting a battle between these two at all. At this point, this person has just decided over some reason that him and I are no longer friends. And I hope this doesn't continue. I hope, Gavin, if you're watching this, that you just keep on doing it like we've been doing the last few years, where you yield for 1 second, let me by, because there's no reason to be bumping into each other. This XR600 weighs a lot more than your KTM 200, and it's, you know, you're probably going to be the one that gets bumped, not me. At this point, I'm screaming. I don't know if you can hear the video, but I'm upset that this is still happening. let me buy there, 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 there. We got to get that figured out for sure. All right, so I catch back up to Dustin, which is surprising. I really think he just waited for me because he wanted to be on camera. I'm sticking to that story. Because the fourth lap, where I wasn't anywhere near him, he dropped 2 minutes off his lap time. He went from like 25s to a low 24. How do you explain that? This was a cool spot of the track. Here we go up this ridge. The trail cuts down and goes to the left here. Right here. Trail goes left. Ended up getting worked straight. And my dad raced in the morning race, and he came back and he said, "Oh, I went straight when it went left, and I ended up between these two palmettos. I ended up like upside down on my back." Here's what he's talking about. These palmettos here, look how tall these things get. You know, they're waist high. Fortunately, I didn't crash like he did. All right, we got another creek crossing. Let's talk about these creek crossings. You have just a second to decide. You have a lot of analyzing to do in a split second. You want to go where it's shallow. You want to go where there's no deep ruts. You want to go where your competitor is not. I mean, if he was in the best line, and it was obviously the best line, I may slow up a little bit. I don't want to get splashed by him. I don't want to ruin my goggles, gloves, boots. Well, here, this creek is kind of generic. There's really no characteristics that tell me which is the best spot, so I'm just going to go ahead and go through the middle. And look how deep it was. It wasn't good. You can hear me complain in the video. I am wet. I should point out, though, that you'll see me kind of strategically turn to the left at the end. Because I don't want to go through those ruts. Those ruts are going to tell my bike where to go. And nobody's the boss of me like that. So I'm going to go left, and I'm going to go across these ruts and stay on top of them. So now I'm wet, got wet gloves, got wet boots, got a wet back. But we're still doing good because we can still see dust. And here's another creek. And this one's much easier to analyze. Let's talk about this one. If we're talking about line choice, let's... Sorry, I rewind and then I don't hit the pause button fast enough to pause it. All right, here we go. This is how quick these line choices have to be. Right now I see this rut. I don't want to be in that rut. If I get in that rut, I have to go all the way through the end of it, and it's going to tell me where to go, and it's going to be slow. And I don't want to go outside that rut because that's just roost. It's just soft. It's the long way. So I want to be here in this green grass. And it's all about risk versus reward. The reward is the green grass, and the risk is that I have to get my bike in these palmettos to get in there. That's what I gotta do. Here we go. Let's analyze this creek. Guess where I don't want to be? Where Evan is right there. Evan, how'd you get there, man? If you're watching this, how did you get in there? You could have gone all the way over here. So this is shorter, obviously. But it's the slower route, right? It's the long way. So you're just kind of finding the easiest route that you're willing to risk, right? You can go slow and you can go way over here. You can bonsai it through here. Just go somewhere in the middle. This is a weird line choice. I don't know if everybody does it, but the preferred line was out here. But this was just so smooth. I mean, my goal is to save energy. We have a finite resource of energy, and you're trying to make it last for 2 hours. And you have to make these small decisions to conserve it. This is a spot I wanted to talk about, but it's too dark. You can't see it. But anyway, there's palmetto roots that go across the trail this way, and they end at this palm tree. So you will see me purposely put my wheel at the end where they meet. I'm putting it in a V essentially. And you have to get close to the palm tree, but the reward is that there's no risk of your front tire slipping if you're intentionally putting it where it would end up slipping anyway. So watch how close I get to that palm tree. I mean, I am running over the roots of the palm tree intentionally to prevent it from slipping. Here we got some double greens. There's no good line here. These whoops are bumpy. They bottom out the XR, but there's where are you gonna go? You gotta go around it, or you gotta go through it. You can't go around it. And then here you'll see me just aiming for some green grass is all I'm doing. This is a good teachable opportunity for anybody who's new to hare scrambles. Let's just talk about risk versus reward. I shouldn't be talking about this because the more people that take these lines, the less smooth lines I have to go on. But this post here is the risk. And that green grass right past the post, that's reward. So you really gotta hug it. And then boom, I got green grass. Right here, I'm doing a less extreme turn, but I'm still not all the way outside. Again, here, right up against the post. And if you watch after this post, I give it some gas and I even get a weird wheelie going because I got so much more traction than I expected. Here, I'm going to hug this post too. Let's talk for a second about your allocation of your energy resources. If you have unlimited energy, the fastest, straightest line is where you want to be. The guys that are out front in our series, Landon, Scott, Sean Clark, these guys are fit and they're going to be up here in this bumpy line most of the time. But I don't have it. I don't have any time to ride during the week. I'm not the most physically fit guy out there. So the only way for me to make a 2 hour race is if I do stuff like this. And I get that 1 second in the smooth grass, and it means so much. And again, here, I go through this left, and I'm going to give it a hard left, hug that post. This is the fast line. But I'm going to be here in this green grass because that is better for me. And it's probably better. If you're watching this video, I bet that's better for you too. Not much else going on here. We got that looks like a good line that I was never brave enough to take. Looked like somebody took it though. Catching up to another A200 rider and an A250 rider. And hey, Gavin, if you're watching this, look, she looks back, she sees I'm not in her class, and she lets me by. Do you think that slowed her down? No, the opposite. She is now going to go faster because she gets to follow a faster rider. And that's what you're supposed to do. Right, this is about the end of the video. I hope that this video helped you. If you guys like this, I'll do more. It doesn't take much of my time. It took about 30 minutes. Well, it took 60 minutes because the first time I recorded it didn't work. But I've got the time, so I'll keep doing them. This is the end of our race, and I don't know what scoring system you guys use in your series, but we've got this cool transponder reader. I've got a transponder under my helmet. And see this screen over here? I wasn't super concerned with it, but if you do want to know what position you're in, you just kind of roll through here and you look over there at the screen and it'll say what position you're in, how far away from the next person you are, what your elapsed time is, what your total time is, etc. It's a pretty cool system. All right, that's it. Let me know what you think.